Russia will respond appropriately to any Western aggression. That's the warning from President Vladimir Putin as tensions rise over Ukraine. He wants security guarantees from the West as he masses his troops on the border. But will he get them? And does diplomacy stand a chance? This is Inside Story. Hello and welcome to the program. I'm Hashem Ahelbarra. The fault lines between Russia and the West regarding Ukraine are getting deeper, and both sides are refusing to back down. On Tuesday, Russia's President Vladimir Putin warned of an appropriate response unless Europe and the US drop their aggressive posturing. The Kremlin rejects accusations it plans to invade the Ukraine capital Kiev as early as next month. It wants NATO and the United States to reduce their presence in Eastern Europe. But Europe says Putin's demands are impossible to keep while Washington is preparing to negotiate over his security concerns.
In the event of the continuation of the obviously aggressive stance by our Western colleagues, we will take appropriate retaliatory military technical measures, reacting firmly to unfriendly actions. And I would like to emphasize, we have the right to do so. We have every right to act to ensure Russia's security and sovereignty.
We have to see if, in the first instance, there's any progress diplomatically. We also want to see Russia de-escalate, to move forces back from the border with Ukraine, to take down the tension. It's much more appropriate to have a conversation in those circumstances than it is when the escalation is happening, not de-escalation.
One of the conditions led out by Russia is to never allow Ukraine into NATO. But Ukraine's leader, Volodymyr Zelensky, says there's a clear time frame for that.
We are striving to unblock the peaceful settlement process in Donbas as quickly as possible, to get Crimea back, to achieve EU membership in the next few years, and to get a very clear time horizon from NATO. Very concrete, and we want it in 2022.
Let's bring in our guests in Moscow, Pavel Felgenhauer, military analyst and columnist for Novaya Gazeta. In Berlin, Thorsten Benner, co-founder and director of the Global Public Policy Institute. Washington, D.C., David DesRoches, professor at National Defense University and former NATO operations director at the Joint Chief of Staff. Welcome to the program. Pavel, can we sum up this whole crisis now as follows? For Moscow to de-escalate on the border with Ukraine, NATO has to roll back from Eastern Europe.
I would say it's bigger than just Ukraine. Ukraine maybe has been the focus point of the Russia-Western standoff, but now it's kind of more, and Russia is talking about not just about Ukraine, but about the entirety of the Russian border, border between Russia and NATO, and that Russia wants to have a secure situation where there are no threatening Western militaries or weapons or anything and appearing there, and those that are there should be withdrawn, and Russia would have a right to have a kind of veto on NATO expansion or NATO deployment, even in countries that are already became NATO members after 97. So it's more than Ukraine. But Ukraine, of course, is the focus point. That's a sure thing.
Thorsten, you would expect all sorts of statements and narratives when it comes to conflicts such as the one we're dealing with. But when your Russian defense minister, Sergei Shoigu, says that U.S. private military companies are plotting provocation using unknown chemical component, how do you see that statement under the background or against the background of the conflict?
Oh, and this is just cynical propaganda to give a pretext for an invasion. This is by far the most dangerous situation militarily we've seen in Europe over the past three decades. I agree with Dmitry Alperovich, the founder of Silverado Accelerator, that all signs point to Putin actually preparing to launch an invasion with a tactical endgame of establishing a puppet state in eastern Ukraine and creating a land bridge to Crimea, but a more strategic endgame, and the Russian colleague alluded to that, to establish some sort of Putin doctrine that no country of the former Soviet Union ever has the idea of trying to join NATO without fearing invasion. And that seems to be the name of the game from the Kremlin side.
David, one of the arguments advanced by President Putin is basically it's about time for NATO to stop those activities, deploying troops at the doorstep of Russia. Is it exactly the way he portrays the situation? Or do you think that one of the biggest concerns of Russia is NATO deploying tactical advanced weapons, particularly missiles, into those areas widely seen by Russia as a massive threat to its national security?
Well, you know, I mean, you've got to start with the precept, you know, Putin's operating from the precept that countries that were part of the Soviet Union or indeed the Warsaw Pact are not fully sovereign, and that Russia, the Soviet Union, you know, has to do it. But I think really what you're seeing here is him jiggling the keys. Look, you know, inflation in Russia is 18%. 40% of Russians have no savings at all. The Nord Stream 2 pipeline will not be approved under the best scenario until the summer. And basically, they're looking at a long, cold, miserable winter with a lot of poor people. And I think he's basically just trying to change the narrative, you know, move to a wartime economy, hopefully without war, just to minimize his vulnerability. The rest of this is all smokescreen.
Pavel, is Russia's biggest concern NATO's deployment in the eastern part of Europe, or is it Russia's obsession with this fear, constant fear that Ukraine and other countries are likely to further drift away from Russia's sphere of influence?
Well, Russia believes that Ukraine as well as Belarus are part of the old great historical Russia and that they should not join Western alliances because in the end, anyway, they should reunite with Russia proper into a greater Russia. Putin wrote about that, the piece that was published this summer, and I know that not only Putin, but many in the Russian ruling elite believe that is so. But there are also some very concrete security concerns, and by Putin personally, because it's an old idea from the 80s, from the time of the Euro missile crisis of the 80s, when American Pershing II missiles were deployed and land-based cruise missiles were deployed in Europe, that the West, the United States, are planning a decapitating first blow to destroy the Russian political military leadership, and so that the Russian military can't be well organized for a reply attack. And that's what Putin is talking about, of these minutes of how quickly the missiles can reach Moscow. Mm-hmm. That means he's talking about himself, that he may be he's the main target. And that's what the Russian general staff is telling the Kremlin, that Putin is the main target. The Americans want to kill Putin. And he believes that is so. And that's why his reaction is very emotional. It's not just a smokescreen. He's really afraid that he's going to be targeted and killed in a sudden American attack.
Thorsten, another argument advanced by Russia is basically the expansion of NATO eastward is almost irrelevant because the political world order now is completely different than before the end of the Cold War.
I don't understand that argument. The expansion is not irrelevant at all. If anything, it's a more pressing concern for the Kremlin than ever, as we've just heard. Those countries who've had the luck of joining NATO and enjoy Article 5 guarantees, they can feel that they're protected by NATO alliance. The problem and the main target is these in-between states that are not part of NATO or any Western institution now, that Russia and or that President Putin considers part of a Russian sphere of influence, and where he, and I don't think it's a smokescreen, these security concerns in the Kremlin, they're very real. Whatever the Kremlin perceives to be a security threat is a security threat. You don't need to be a hyper-constructivist to see that. And they at the very least, if not for, you know, if not realizing these pan-Russian empire dreams, at least they want buffer states that they de facto control, because the Kremlin is indeed afraid for its security and also regime survival. Imagine if Belarus, Ukraine, Georgia, all these countries turned into some sort of democracy. That would also be threatening from the vantage point of a corrupt regime in the Kremlin.
David, you served as NATO's operations director, the Joint Chief of Staff, and you know, the Russians have been saying, at least as far as Putin is concerned, there's always this post-Soviet mindset, which is 1997, we were told, in the early 90s, the Russians were told to join the Partnership for Peace Pact, and then they were told the troops will be remain stationed as per 1997, but that war suddenly collapsed and the NATO started to move forward and reaching out to different countries. This is a massive, massive security threat for the Russians, which they don't want to see replicated anytime soon. And this explains their zero tolerance as far as Ukraine is concerned.
Yeah, this is all hogwash. Look, the regime threat that Putin is concerned about is a color revolution. And the reason why he's done that is because he hasn't delivered anything for his people. NATO expansion happened, vocal assurances were made during the time of Gorbachev, you know, to the Soviet Union, which ceased to exist. The arrangement changed. And when NATO expanded, it didn't expand with a focus on Russia. You know, Polish troops weren't armed to go to the Polish border by NATO. They were armed to go to Afghanistan. Mm-hmm. The United States withdrew every single tank from Europe in 2014. And they remained withdrew until Putin invaded the Crimea and annexed it. What we've got here is there's not a legitimate NATO threat. You know, there weren't even war plans to defend the Baltic republics for over a year after their accession, or over a decade after their accession. Mm-hmm. This is hogwash. What you have here is a guy who has a vulnerable domestic position because he's delivered nothing for his people other than this idea of a return to the great glories of the Soviet Union. You know, a few days ago, the Russian hockey team played in the old Soviet Union jerseys against Finland. They lost, so I guess he took them back to 1940. But, all this stuff about NATO expansion is just hogwash. Traditionally, when a country joins NATO, their defense spending actually decreases. They actually spend less money on that. And I can tell you that, you know, I've never seen any contemplation of offensive action, only, you know, updating plans from the Cold War. And finally, we've got to bear in mind, Russia occupies a big part of Crimea or a big part of Ukraine. They've completely annexed the Crimea. This is not as if there's just something coming from the West. There's a 7-year war going on that was directed and bankrolled by Russia. And the fact that Putin's been unable to deal with a corrupt, inefficient country in 7 years, that undermines his image as a strong man, too. So now's a good time for him to try and rattle some cages.
Pavel, why do you think the Russian leadership, Putin in particular, is insisting on the security guarantees to be met before any de-escalation on the border with Ukraine?
I say it's a bigger picture than just Ukraine. For Russia, as about Ukraine, Russia right now is very adamant that there be no NATO accession, no accession to the European Union, and Russia will do what it takes, no matter what, to prevent that. But the picture, as I say, is bigger. Russia is demanding security guarantees on the entirety of the eastern flank of NATO, and Russia is demanding that right now very adamantly. Why right now the situation has come to a forefront? Well, that's very complicated. The reply will be very complicated and long. Well, basically, the Russian military had plans enacted more than 10 years ago to build up the Russian military for a possibility of a big war in Europe in the 20s. So now, according to plan, Russia is more or less ready, though the kind of date of war was about 24, 25. But anyway, right now we're ready, and that's what Putin and his generals said yesterday at this big meeting in Moscow, that right now we're number one. We have hyperspeed missiles. America does not. So right now Russia has an advantage and most likely should use that military advantage to get political concessions.
Okay. Thorsten, how do you explain the fact that the Russians still, or at least the top priority for them now, is a ban on Ukraine entering the NATO? And we know that from 2014, NATO has never shown any genuine appetite to have Ukraine on board.
I mean, look, what they've said, I think, from the Kremlin's vantage point, is exactly confirmation of their concerns and fears. I agree with Dave on Russia violating international law and its commitments under the Budapest memorandum to Ukraine. That's all crystal clear. But to say that all these guarantees about not expanding NATO, they were given to the Soviet Union, and that Soviet Union ceased to exist, so they were no longer valid, and it was totally fine to expand NATO because it wasn't at all directed at Russia. From the Kremlin's vantage point, that's exactly proof of the duplicitous, hypocritical nature of the U.S. and its NATO allies. And they're very concerned about expanding NATO, but they're even concerned about Ukraine. I mean, I think one thing the Kremlin has learned over the past years, a Ukraine that is not part of NATO, but still is able to purchase advanced weapons from NATO partners, such as these drones they purchased from Russia, is maybe even more unpredictable. And they simply don't trust President Zelensky on eastern Ukraine. They think he's out there to retake that territory. They want to preempt that. I'm not at all justifying this, but I think we do in the West need to understand the rationale of the Kremlin for doing this. And I think it goes beyond just diverting from the very dire economic and socioeconomic situation at home. This is not just a diversion tactic. I think this is going after some very real goals for the Kremlin.
David, the whole narrative is widely seen as a saber rattling just for the sake of political compromise any time soon. Now, from an American and European perspective, how do you see the compromise if it ever happens?
Yeah, it's really tough. I mean, look, NATO operates by consensus. So I cannot imagine a situation in which Lithuania, Latvia, Estonia, and Poland all agree that there shall be no NATO deployments in their territory. That's not going to happen. The intermediate nuclear range forces, you know, Russia's movement of screwdriver missiles into Europe, there probably will be some sort of a reaction to that. There's a possibility for a compromise there, but it won't be a compromise that allows Russia to keep its intermediate nuclear missiles in place. The fact is the U.S. stopped producing those missiles 30 years ago, so it would take us a long time to match that. Other things that Russia's done, the test of the anti-satellite missile weapon, the hypersonic missiles that's been mentioned earlier, those are all technological things that eventually, you know, once the capabilities match, presumably they can be negotiated away. But the bigger issue, I think, comes down to Ukraine. And I think really what might be the framework for a settlement is certainly not a publicly released thing that we saw, but there might be some sort of agreement for routinization of relations with areas of Ukraine that are occupied. And finally, I don't, you know, the alliance can't give any indication that it won't expand later on. But I can assure you, you know, we never thought Ukraine would be ready for NATO membership. I mean, I don't think I'll live long enough to see it meeting the criteria for that. But what Putin is doing is forcing countries that are non-aligned, like Finland and Sweden, into cooperation with NATO. So you're kind of seeing a self-fulfilling prophecy here. You know, paranoia really is its own reward.
Pavel, so this whole thing about the need for NATO to stop expanding eastward is widely seen by people just as an anxiety from the Russians about the wind of change. The moment it continues blowing eastward, it's going to arrive on the shores of Russia. And this is exactly the existential threat for Putin. He does not want to see genuine winds of change and democracy in the area.
No, of course, the Kremlin argues that Russia does have a democracy, while the West democracies are not fully democracies or have many deficiencies. But that's, of course, just simply propaganda stuff, and it's not really the major issue. The major issue is rather geopolitical, also actually demographic, because it's not only Putin, it's a large portion of the Russian ruling elite, ministers and top Russian diplomats telling to me even 20 years ago that don't worry, the Russian population is contracting, but we're going to add up the half of Ukraine, all of Belarus, half of Kazakhstan, where there's Slavic people, 30 million Slavic people will join Russia, and at least, and everything is going to be just fine, don't worry. So that's been very much in the minds of the Russian, not only the Kremlin, but the entirety of the Russian elite, or a big portion of it. That Western encroachments are going to ruin the idea of gathering all the Russian speakers in one nation, in one kind of empire, and so that should be opposed with all possibilities, with all means, because that's the future of Russia that the West wants to take away.
Thorsten, does it also raise a question about the need for NATO itself to reinvent itself, because the world is changing and they need to have to understand ultimately that with Russia, there is absolutely no way you can just go ahead towards a confrontation, because it's not going to benefit anyone?
I think you're right. This doesn't, you know, it's a very tragic situation, most of all for Ukrainians, and with no good outcomes inside. But I think very immediately we need to think, how can we prevent this invasion from happening? And two things need to happen. On the one hand, the US and if the Kremlin wants to, European partners, they need to engage in negotiations with Russia. And second of all, there needs to be very credible deterrence in place on the part of the US and European partners, that Moscow will indeed pay a high price if it moved toward invading Ukraine. It needs to be clear this will not be just an easy invasion for the Kremlin. They'll pay a high economic price for this. Of course, it's in a situation with sky high energy prices. This is not an easy situation for Europe, but we do need to put everything on the table in terms of deterrence.
David, you talk about the NATO as if it were a united stance, a united voice, but in a way or another, many Europeans are saying we cannot indefinitely rely on the Americans, because we've seen former administration doing business with the Russians in a different way. Is this something that Putin can use to his own political advantage for more leverage?
Yeah, I think he's trying to drive a wedge. Look, Putin is achieving a lot of the... He already has in place a lot of the situations that the United States feared during the Reagan administration period of the Cold War. And that is that he has a natural gas pipeline directly to Europe, which the Reagan administration fought tooth and nail. So he has Western Europe that's economically dependent on Russia. And he also has intermediate nuclear weapons present in Europe with the screwdriver missiles that he can move back and forth. So these were considered nightmare scenarios in the 1980s, and the threat was that they would cleave Europe and the United States and allow Putin to defeat Europe in detail, which is kind of what he's doing. So the problem is, the military capacity, NATO cannot muster 100 battalions to match the 100 battalions that Putin's massed on Ukraine. So I don't think the West is looking at countering this militarily. And as I said earlier, if we're going to reconstitute something like Pershing, that's going to take 15 years. We shut down those assembly lines. So there's a you know, there really is an imbalance here on the military side in the favor of Russia. And I think that leads the West to look towards the political and economic solutions, which they're already inclined to fix.
Unfortunately, we're running out of time, and let's hope that diplomacy will finally prevail. Pavel, Felgenhauer, Thorsten, Benner, and David DesRoches, I really appreciate your insight. Thank you. And thank you, too, for watching. You can see the program again anytime by visiting our website, aljazeera.com, for further discussion. Go to our Facebook page. That's facebook.com/AJInsideStory. You can also join the conversation on Twitter. Our handle is @AJInsideStory. For me, Hashem Ahelbarra, and the entire team here in Doha. Bye for now.